Chiragi Khandelwal is the co-founder and director of Ajivika Bureau. Ajivika is the public service initiative headquartered in Udaipur that provides service on and solutions to migrant workers and their household in the state of Rajasthan, Gujarat, and Maharashtra. Ajivika Bureau has earned national recognitions for its contributions in the domain of informal work and labor migrations. Under his stewardship, Ajivika Bureau has designed many innovative programs in late stage skilling, financial access, and social security for migrant workers. Based on its practice and research, Ajivika works closely with research and policy bodies and has contributed to the knowledge and policy making on migration. Chiragi is a postgraduate in rural management from IRMA. He has practiced in academic programs at INSEAD and Harvard Kennedy School. He has practiced extensively and speaks nationally and internationally on the subject of migration, labor, and livelihoods based on his vast research and experience. He was elected as an Ashoka Fellow in 2005. In 2010, in the World Economic Forum, recognized his work as declared him as the Social Entrepreneur of the Year. Sri Rajiv Khandelwal will now address the gathering in online mode. Sir, please.
Thank you very much. I hope I'm clear, and good morning from across the country. I am joining you from Udaipur, South Rajasthan, and it's a moment of great privilege to be part of your Foundation Day symposium. I do know about DMI, and I hope there will be a chance soon to visit and be in your midst physically as well. For now, we have to live with the virtual reality of coming to know each other through this medium, but better that we at least meet than not. And I think in that sense, I'm very grateful to Professor Debi Misra and his colleagues, your faculty members, to think of me to address and meet the students. The work of Ajivika Bureau that you have just mentioned and described is around labor migration. And I will bring to you some perspectives on what large numbers of migrant workers, the number is not small, but what large numbers of migrant workers are confronted with as we enter the post-COVID, if at all there is something like a post-COVID era, if we enter a post-COVID era, what are they confronted with? Let us not forget that just a few months ago, we saw some of the most moving, shocking scenes of misery inflicted on migrant workers who were forced to leave cities, forced to leave their temporary homes and shelters and get back to their rural homes. In fact, where all of you are at this time, in Patna, Bihar, Bihar saw millions of people return from far away. Millions of people of the kind who make the cities and industries of, you know, rest of the country, notably in Western India and South India. Where I am in Rajasthan, our migrant workers go to Gujarat and Maharashtra, and of course deeper south. And again, thousands of them returned pretty much without notice, without any preparation, and without, but more seriously, without without wages and without the security that comes to all of us, through our employment kind of contracts and relationships. The numbers of rural migrants is not small, and you know, you will have Professor Chinmay Tumhe, who has researched internal migration in India very, very deeply, and it's The numbers may be debated, but it is for sure that at the least, we are talking about 140 to 160 million people who migrate seasonally from their villages and enter cities and industries and farm and agriculture areas to provide their hard labor. Most of these workers are vulnerable, bottom-end participants in the economy. They are workers who are entering the economy without formal contracts or documentation. They're often coming through labor agents, intermediaries, and contractors, and therefore their direct relationship with their employers is not very explicit or clear. These are workers who may also be coming out of poverty and distress, and therefore have taken an advance or a small loan from their contractors who are then putting them to work, thus bringing them into a cycle of what we describe as debt bondage. From where I work, which is South Rajasthan, this is the Adivasi area, it's a tribal area. That is the face of labor migration here. It is distress driven. It is not driven just by opportunity. It is driven by the fact that people just do not have enough to feed their families and enough to make ends meet at homes, which is why cities and industries will provide the wages that they require so much. One of the realities that we saw just immediately after the lockdown may have shocked the middle classes of this country quite a bit, but the fact is that these realities were not new. In fact, the realities they always existed. Some of us always were aware of these realities, of the vulnerability, of the precarity in which people live and work, but they just became amplified in a almost unprecedented way for migrants, and gave them an identity of sorts. As a group, it gave them an identity. Of course, it does not take long to forget people's miseries, especially when it is other people's miseries. And so we are probably already at a point in our national kind of priority framework where migrants and informal workers have already taken a backseat. But let us not forget that it is informal work, it is labor migration that forms the very, very core of our economy. Whether or not COVID has been solved, informal work is here to, will continue to stay and will remain. And it is the challenges of that form of employment, that nature of engagement of people, that pattern of survival that we have to address squarely and substantially in times to come. As I said, the figure that is quite well known is that almost about 92% of our entire workforce is actually unorganized and informal. That's a shocking proportion of the workforce. And what informal means is that these are workers, 92% of our entire workforce will go without formal contracts, goes without social security, goes without stability and guarantee of employment, goes without access to basic services that many of us take for granted, that just seems to come with our own jobs and employment kind of opportunities in more formal setups, such as public sector undertakings or academic institutions or factories that are mandated to run in a certain way. Now, given that there is such overwhelming number, it's clearly policies that need, policies are required that ensure that protection and stability of this workforce remains kind of top priority. So that's on the workforce side. Let us also remember that it is the breakdown of our rural economy. It is the exhaustion of our own agriculture system that has resulted in this large out migration of workers from rural areas. We have just not done enough to create adequate employment for our rural populations, which is why areas such as Bihar, Jharkhand, Odisha, Bengal, and areas such as where I'm joining you from, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, these are areas that just do not create enough employment, and people will have to get out in order to find work. And the it is a matter, it is not just circumstantial. I think there is a policy kind of a breakdown here where agriculture and allied kind of resources have been neglected to the privilege of urban and industrial kind of development and growth. And I think that itself will need to be corrected as we look at future possibilities, future revival and so on. But I'll come back to that point in a bit. I wanted to highlight a few more issues that are of relevance to the informal migrant workforce, given that it is such a large number of people in, you know, such a large part of our population. Firstly, we know this not just from our experience, but also through our studies and research, that we have amongst the lowest wage rates anywhere in the world. Wages are appallingly low in our country. Okay, and in a strange way, they have been mandated to remain low, even through government orders. There is the national floor minimum wage. The national floor wage, a couple of years ago, was determined at 178 rupees per day, which is below starvation kind of level. You know, nobody should be earning just 178 rupees a day. Even government's own commission would recommend 378 rupees a day, which was never actually implemented. So really, if you take into account the fact that almost 40% of our informal migrant workforce earns less than the minimum wage, it means that people are actually surviving on very little. They're surviving not just on their wages, but also financing their survival through debt, through loans, often from private kind of money lenders and from non-institutional kind of means. So low wages is a reality of our economy and a reality of the livelihood that we are discussing in this symposium. Of course, it must be questioned why wages should remain low, especially given the fact that there doesn't seem to be a shortage of surplus in the economy. The surplus is only kind of concentrated in one part of the economy, and it does not flow naturally to the very bottom end, the workforce that actually creates that surplus. That's one part that we must keep in mind as you talk about livelihoods. Secondly, the access to basic entitlements, which is PDS, which is ration, healthcare, housing, nutrition, transportation, cover in the case of injury and accidents, these kinds of basic entitlements remain very difficult for migrant and informal workers to access. The reality is that most entitlements are tied to domicile, which means that if you are a worker from Bihar, then you will not be able to access any of these entitlements in Maharashtra or Karnataka, because you don't belong to Maharashtra or Karnataka. You may, of course, live there for 10 months a year, but still you will not be able to access ration there. You will not be able to enter the public housing kind of, benefits. Healthcare might elude you. All the local state entitlements will not be yours because you don't belong there. So it's the fact that portability of entitlements does not exist. Universal access does not exist. It actually further compromises the well-being of workers who are forced to depend on low wages. See, in a scenario where wages are low, if entitlements were to be more universally available, then it is possible to at least survive. But low wages and not enough public provisioning means that basic survival itself becomes a problem. Yeah, so that's the second kind of major scenario that we are confronted with. The third area that we must remember for migrant workers and informal workers is that this is a large population which is often confronted with the reality of unwarranted wage losses, wage denials, and wage frauds, which means that what people ought to be earning, they may not earn. Their contractors and agents may not give them what they promised them. I already said studies are showing 40% of the entire kind of informal workforce doesn't even get minimum wages. New forms of wage payments have come about, and we are seeing this even in the scenario, in the post-lockdown scenario, when the economy is surviving, you know, so a lot of workers are actually moving from daily wage labor-based system to piece-rated systems, which means that itna kaam hai, you will get this much money. Now, that's a very, very manipulative way of paying wages, and it creates all kinds of, you know, false deductions and false kind, you know, difficult to understand and comprehend kind of, you know, wage payment structures that workers do not grasp. So in the event of denial of wages or wage frauds, what is each option that workers have? They cannot turn to, you know, local labor department or local unions or local police, you know, kind of administration for support. They just basically let wages go. So loss of wages and involuntary loss of wages is a huge reality in our entire workforce. And I'm marking it as a livelihood issue, that if we were to be, if people were to be paid what they were promised or what is due to them, at least they'll, you know, their chances of survival would improve. But studies are repeatedly showing that we are an economy that is built on the morality of stealing money from our workers. Okay. And that's the third big reality that we have to kind of, you know, contend with as we look at the future of livelihoods in our country. The fourth, that workers are, you know, they ultimately will get back to their rural areas. Our seasonal workforce, our seasonal migrants are not looking to settle in cities. For them, their final return is in rural areas. Okay. For the duration, so there is, so it's seasonal and circular migration. It is not permanent relocation of workers. Okay. Which means that for the duration that they are in urban areas, they certainly need to be supported. But there is also a big question about what confronts them when they are back home. Okay. And this is a question that I'm sure all of you who are in Bihar, Jharkhand, which are where rural livelihoods are so, you know, so stretched and so stressed, have to think about in a very significant way. You know, what is the, you know, in, we are seeing here in Rajasthan that there is early entry in the labor market and there is early return, which means at the age of 30, 37, you know, migrant workers are coming back and their children are starting to migrate. And, but these are 37-year-old, you know, you and I, our work lives are peaking at this time, but we have this entire huge workforce that is retiring from the economy. But to what end? You know, is there hope for them and scope to kind of integrate them in some meaningful way, in some meaningful economic and dignified way when they get back to their villages? You know, so these are, I'm just highlighting these as the significant kind of issues that mark the livelihood reality of our workforce. There's, of course, you know, there's other things, you know, what is the direction in which industrial development is growing, you know, what kind, what is the nature of jobs that is arising? Is the job secure, stable, dignified, or is it insecure, temporary, and dangerous? Let us remember that we have amongst the highest rates of accidents and injuries at workplace anywhere in the world. Our factories and construction sites are like war zones, right? There are so many reported, and then you can imagine how many unreported accidents and fatalities on our work sites. Why should that be? You know, why should workers lose fingers and limbs and lives while at work? The usual kind of, you know, solution that is offered is to make the worker secure, you know, give him a mask, give him a helmet. However, let us remember that we have the most dangerous work sites. Our workers are not dangerous. It's the work site which is dangerous, which needs to be made safer. So the whole reality of the place of work being a dangerous and hazardous place of work, you know, has to be contended with almost as a livelihood reality. And I say this because amongst many segments of migrant workers, we have found tuberculosis to be twice as prevalent as compared to the national average. Now, that's not a coincidence, right? It is because there is the work and living conditions are forcing people to breathe in toxic kind of, you know, air and live in very bad conditions that is leading to tuberculosis. We have silicosis, which is a fatal disease that is found only among workers of a certain category. So the reality of unsafe work conditions and unsafe, you know, terms of engagement itself has to be dealt with and has to be contended with. So what are we looking at as we go forward? Have things changed, you know, in the post-COVID scenario? And I think about it, of course, things, you know, I'm sure a lot of us would agree that we have all become, what should I say, very accustomed to thinking about the future on webinars, okay, and on platforms like this. But the reality that we see in cities like Ahmedabad, Surat, Mumbai, which are cities that we know, that I know more closely and more, and in a more personal way because we work there, this reality is there is not changing very much. Actually, people are back to where they left it, when they left the cities. And actually things are worse because there's also no COVID to contend with. All our discussions around making our cities more inclusive, making our urban areas more benign, and you know, making our cities more friendly to migrant workers and informal workers, those discussions still remain only at the level of discussion. You know, very little has changed on the ground actually. But the good thing is that through this period, I think there is a consciousness that the workers need a special attention. There's some renewal of at least focus on the reality of informality and the reality of migration in our country. And I think we must keep the discussion going on what needs to change. And I will basically draw upon the problems and challenges that I mentioned and highlight four or five future kind of, you know, steps that we ought to put in place, we ought to work towards together as we reconstruct our economy for and reconstruct the livelihood kind of reality for India's informal and migrant workforce. Okay. One of the first things that I have also written about and I argue for quite a bit is that we must move towards greater formalization. Okay. That we should question the idea of continue to be an informal economy, that our workers at such large proportion remain informal. I think that itself has to start changing. Now, what does formalization mean? It means that our workers must have more formal work contracts. They must have social security. Their employment relationships must become more visible and more explicit. Okay, they cannot be left to oral, informal, feudal kind of ways. They have to become more located in the more modern kind of context. Of course, this is not happening anytime soon, but especially because we thrive on informality. But I think government and industry policy should encourage formalization, not informalization. It should continue to examine ways in which workers are being made informal and challenge that rather than create new forms of informality. There is a whole lot of debate around how informality is actually creeping into formal organizations as well, by increasing the contractual kind of, you know, workforce, by making it difficult, by making it easier for industry and employers to eject workers without notice, by creating conditions in which retrenchment itself becomes quite easy, or by taking away the responsibility of providing social security or basic kind of, you know, entitlements, taking it away from employers and putting it in the hand of the state, that the state will do it, whereas employers and you know, industries need to be doing this. But formalization is one of the big steps forward, and we must argue for it in the new post-COVID livelihood reconstruction. The other thing that I often argue, call for is universal access. That no longer is it feasible to imagine our country as a divided country between Biharis and Gujaratis and Jharkhandis and Marathis. You know, we function as an integrated economy, okay? Which means that there has to be portability of entitlements for workers, regardless of where they come from. Cities have to become universally accessible. They cannot be divided up on domicile lines. And certain basic entitlements have to become available to all. And what are those entitlements? It is ration. It is housing. It is healthcare. It is nutrition and transportation. They have to be publicly provided. This has to be publicly provided. And by mean, I mean by publicly provided meaning that there has to be public subsidy to workers who are in cities who need these basic provisions in order to survive in cities. It is really critical to do this because wages will continue to remain low. Our wages are not going to be corrected anytime soon. We cannot have an unsustainable situation in which wages remain below starvation levels and, you know, everything else also remains very expensive. What is it turning this masses of people to? It is making them hungry, undernourished and indebted. So we need to change that by creating greater and universal access to entitlements. Okay, that is the second. The third thing that I would strongly argue for is look at critical conditions that resulted in the large scale misery on migrants during the lockdown. As soon as the lockdown, let us take housing. Okay, we have to solve the housing issue in cities. Currently, migrants are forced to live in very informal kind of settlements, which are not even part of the city mapping. Okay, they are just seen as informal, illegal, unauthorized kind of. They're not, and I'm not talking about slums. Slums actually become irregular at one point. But open spaces which are occupied by migrant workers, informal areas that serve as temporary kind of habitat for migrant workers, they have to come into the purview of provisioning by cities. They have to be identified, not for the purpose of eviction, not for the purpose of throwing people out or chasing them out of, you know, where they're living for a few months, but actually providing for them, creating sanitation, creating food, creating nutrition, ensuring Anganwadis, so on and so forth in these spaces. So recognizing the informality of living conditions has to become quite important. Housing has to be solved for migrants in cities. It was lack of housing that resulted in this large-scale expulsion of people. Let us remember, you know, another reality that we see often is that workers actually, where do they live? You know, if they're not living in rented rooms or in open spaces, they're actually living inside factories and on construction sites. Now, living inside a factory is actually a very, it's a tough one. You know, you're basically becoming bonded to your workplace and you will work forever. You know, there is no getting out of, you know, that kind of relationship. But if you have public housing, you have cheaply provided, decent, dignified housing, then you'll have an option, right? So housing is a major issue, right, which will solve the livelihood crisis of workers as well. Yeah. Fourthly, and I say this with the full understanding that this is not easy, is to re-examine opportunities in rural areas, okay? One argument, and you know, if you must read the I hope you get access to the India Livelihood Report, which has just been put out, and Dr. Vijay Mahajan has written a superb kind of editorial. We did a chapter in that report, and you know, one of the propositions that he's making is that we look the location of industrial activity closer to sources of labor. You know, why should people have to travel such long distances to find work? Why can't we go back to the idea of building smaller towns, smaller urban centers as industrial centers, as nodes of providing employment, so that supply chains actually become more efficient and workers are able to be closer home? And I think this is not a new idea, but you know, I think it just needs emphasis. It needs the non-farm sector has to become more robust, closer to where workers are coming from. And it will reduce distress, it will make the people's kind of journey less arduous and create more even development in the country than is currently the case. Yeah? Otherwise, development and growth just continues to be so hugely kind of, you know, beset with a disparity. So looking at rural livelihoods again, not giving up on agriculture, at least where there is land, and I know, you know, areas like Bihar do not even have, you know, enough land to offer to its rural workers. But you know, certainly places like Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan, where we come from, you know, there is productivity, lack of productivity has just been taken for granted, you know. And I think more opportunities, more employment opportunities on land can be created if we were to realign our policy attention to the potential of agriculture. Yeah, so that's the whole area of rural livelihoods, strengthening that, ensuring that, and lastly ensuring that workers have access to justice, that wage frauds, denial of wages, stealing money from workers, non-payments of wages needs a strong national consensus and a national kind of agreement on not being acceptable. And there needs to be systems in place which are not just based on creation of evidence. There's no evidence. Workers do not come with evidence of employment. They come just on verbal contracts, right? So a system of justice that does not put the burden of creating evidence on the worker, but ensures accountability on employers and contractors to make sure that workers are paid on time, paid minimum wages, if not living wages, that absolutely has to become, you know, one of the core of our kind of workforce revival. It goes hand in hand with the idea of safety, and it goes hand in hand with the idea of ensuring safe workplaces, so that workers are not pushed into accidents or terminal illnesses or, you know, life-altering kind of accidents and so on. So we need a framework of justice that workers can kind of turn to, and we should look at it not just as a human rights kind of a concern, but as a livelihood response, because workers, we should not, you know, we should be paid for what we, for the work that we do. There should not be any other way to do this. I will stop here. I know I've thrown many ideas around. Some of them may not be very coherent, but I speak from the idea that migration is here to stay. You know, rural migration is not going to be reversed anytime soon. You know, that's the way, that's a reality. But it can certainly become more dignified. It can become more rewarding. It need not be a one-way street of, you know, of exploitation for workers. It can work for everyone. I think we can create conditions by which workers, industries, and the public spaces can all grow together. And I'm glad that, you know, that is being recognized. There are now industries waking up to the fact of making their supply chains more clean, more dignified. And that is no longer seen as, you know, something so far away. If we have to become globally relevant and competitive, we have to do more and better for our workforce. And I think that is the opportunity that we must seize and not let go of it in the wake of our states, our cities coming back and out of COVID. Thank you very much for this opportunity. If there are questions, you'll have to unmute yourself because I can't hear you.
So am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. Yeah.
So thank you so much, first of all, for some stimulating insights that you shared through your address. So I have a question pertaining to the skill certification. You talked about formalization of work. Do you think skill certification would contribute in some way towards doing that? Your take on that, sir?
You're asking for skill certification, right? Yeah.
Yes,
I think absolutely. I think skill certification is very, very important. And there are also schemes that do that, that actually help, you know, which is basically they recognize prior learning. So you don't have to go through a fresh set of training to become certified. You can also be certified as a plumber if, you know, if you go through a small kind of take a small test or something. Skill certification is important, but let's remember that it will be necessary, but far from being sufficient. It will not be sufficient. I think at the core of formalization is the idea that work relations will become formal. So it means that whoever is employing, whether a contractor or an agent or a principal employer, will have certain minimum responsibilities on the front of wages, secure social security and safety to the worker. Okay, if those are in place, then a certified skill will work. But you know, we know many cases which highly skilled people get highly exploited, and I don't think that is the way we want formalization to work, right? We need to make it work in terms of the very basis of employment that is getting created. So yeah, so skill certification will certainly work, but it needs an ecosystem of formal arrangements.
Thank you, sir.
Very good morning, sir. This is Rishilo from BMI, sir. Quick question about the labor wages during the pandemic and post-pandemic opportunities in Rajasthan. What exactly you may have some idea, maybe, or some scenario kind of what exactly is happening with the labor markets in Rajasthan?
You know, your voice broke. Then maybe somebody else can repeat the question. I know you're talking about wages, but
yes, somebody wages. Else...
Just right now, as at this point, wages in the cities of Gujarat, for example, are I would say they're about 60-70% of pre-lockdown stage, okay, in several sectors, for example, in manufacturing, in the garment industry, in some parts of the construction sector, in several service oriented sectors like hospitality, wages are really down. They have not come back to normal. Okay. The other thing that has happened is that many, as I mentioned it in my talk, that many wage based employment has moved to piece rated based employment. So basically, work is being offered and the wages are not being paid on time, but on the amount of work that worker does, and say, "Itna kaam hai, aap kar lo." Okay, that is a way in which wages get cheapened, wages get lowered, and the argument is that there's not enough work, so you know, just take what you are being offered. We are looking at least another 4 to 6 months of kind of gradual normalization. You know, it will normalize. So certainly, certain sectors like hospitality or tourism that have really taken a bad hit. They might take longer. Manufacturing, many places are still recovering, but wages are only limping back to normal, you know, slowly limping back to normal. This is in fact a time when we needed some kind of a wage insurance, you know, when people are without wages, some kind of wage padding of wages was needed. And one of the new kind of ideas that has been floated is the idea of creating an urban employment guarantee. That like NAREGA, which is for rural areas, that we should also think about creating an urban employment guarantee, which offers and guarantees work at dignified wages to workers in cities, regardless of where they come from, again, not make it domicile based or Aadhaar based, ensure that workers have at least minimum wages available to them in return of work in urban areas. You know, that argument, that whole idea needs to be built up further, actually. Please also identify yourself. I don't know any of you. So,
good morning, sir. I am Devashish Kutu. I am an associate professor here in DMI. I have a question. It was nice to hear the presentation which I expressed. It was very good and very learning experience. I would like to know, sir, this contractual system at all levels is becoming a reality. Even the government is now also going towards that, and everything is moving towards contractual system. On the other hand, the labor laws, it is being said that the labor laws needs to be diluted further. These are stringent and they need to be diluted further so for the industrial growth. The labor codes are again not functioning, almost, I mean, de facto non-functioning. So, I mean, when we are increasing the contracture, I mean, the contractual employment, parallelly when the legal system needs to be made more efficient, we are going the other way around. So, what is the way out in this type of a situation?
No, I think you've got it really right, Devashish, because with increasing kind of informal arrangements, actually the legal system should be stronger, should be made stronger, because informal arrangements will always find, you know, ways of deviously cheating or exploiting the worker, you know, but the whole labor governance is being hollowed out. Now, what is the way out? I think one way out is, of course, you know, kind of build the policy that, you know, argue for a policy of improving labor governance itself. You know, we cannot, you know, we cannot privatize labor administration. It has to be a state role, you know, and okay, right now labor codes have actually almost authorized contractual work. Fixed term employment has been, you know, made totally legitimate, has been made legitimate. But then make sure that contract workers have access to all forms of services and entitlements that full-time workers do. And ensure it through vigilance and enforcement. There's no other way but to beef up the labor administration and labor governance. Nobody else is going to do it, right? However, it'll not be done. You and I know that this will not be done very easily. You know, labor department will continue to be the weakest department. And I think in that sense, the second role would come to trade unions, okay? That unions need to start including migrant workers, especially, and contract workers, to be able to represent their interests more forcefully. Again, it's not an easy one, but that's the other scenario that we must kind of work on. Thirdly, civil society needs to get to work. Everybody who was so concerned about food and the misery of people walking on foot back to Bihar, they need to get back into work and now talk about wages and protection of wages and legal aid to workers. Okay, that short-lived temporary sympathy has to sustain, because that is continues to be needed for the way people are treated at their workplace. So we need more labor activism, more labor practice in labor, in industrial markets, in urban areas and so on. We are severely short of that. We run a helpline, Devashish, which is a workers' helpline. It's a toll-free number that is, you know, which we have popularized across many geographies. We receive 3,000 calls a month, of which about 10-15% are of outright distress, okay? And a worker saying ki paisa nahi mila, pakad ke rakha hua hai, maar peet kar rahe hai, this and that. Now we need more of the such, you know, these kinds of interventions, which are not in the state space, but in the civil society space. And we, you know, that labor line, by the way, does very well. We are making that labor line actually national, and we'll take it to different geographies. But we need more work on the labor front. You know, more work that I don't think the state is going to kind of do just left to itself, because they don't see labor as a political constituency anymore. Yeah, but we need more. And there's no way to say that labor governance ke bina kaam chal jayega, nahi chalega. In a situation of informality, we need more labor governance, not less.
Even the labor unions, when we talk about the labor unions, if you look at C2 or IMTUC and all this labor unions, majority are concentrated to the organized sector. I mean, hardly will find for the unorganized sector. It is more, and that too, if you find it is more in the public sector, not exactly in the private sector, of course, yeah, private sector, if you look at big industries, yes. But in the small industries, very little. And unorganized sector, hardly any.
Yeah. No, it's a gap, and I think they are very aware of it. And you know, the trade union movement overall is becoming weaker. It is also being made weaker. You know, it's not just becoming weaker by itself. The role of trade unions, the role of collective bargaining itself has been kind of has been devalued. But I just feel that more unionization is important, and it should not be seen as anti-industry. You know, look at Germany. Of course, you know, we are too far away, you know, to talk about Germany, but Germany, they make unions central to their business. You know, they don't see them as combative or adversarial. You know, they see it as part of the industrial growth process, you know, but we've just made this whole idea of unionization as a anti-employment, anti-worker, anti-industry idea, which needs to change. We need more unionism, not less. Okay. But, you know, that's the reality. You know, migrant workers are also harder to unionize because they will not stay in one place. They will move, they'll go away. They're not a stable constituency, right? So that is a reality. But the central trade unions are no longer unaware of this. And many of them have chapters that try to include unorganized sector workers. New forms of unionization is happening, but just compared to the quantum of the workforce, I've just recently traveled in many industrial areas, Gujarat and in Maharashtra and Pune, for example. Absolutely nobody is there. No one works there. You know, we need more. And there, I mean, Pune has, I've run into thousands of Bihari workers and Jharkhand workers, and who have basically just left to their own devices to figure it out. But, you know, they've actually figured it out how to do this. It is done socially and culturally, not legally. Their problems are solved through cultural and social means, not through legal means.
Yeah, they could have made a member of the board, even the union can be a part of the board members, one of the representatives stand on the board.
Yeah.
Thank you. I work for Mini Metro and Congress. I wanted to talk from the opposite end, two sectors. One is agricultural and the second one is construction. Both these sectors witnessed increase in wages, not decrease. Now, the problem with both these sectors, these are, you need some kind of expertise to work in these sectors. You can't be totally zero. So some certification can be done. But as soon as we add these certifications or some formalization like insurance, provident fund, this will again increase the cost of the person who is organizing this, the organization or the company. Can be other organizations like GMR, or they can be small TKR. So who is ultimately going to pay for this? Do you want the government to get involved in it, or should the business get involved in it?
No, that's actually at the heart of the matter. Who will pay for increased labor welfare? Will pay for housing, for more food and this and that. And I think that is a question that we must work on together. You know, of course, you know, you must ask this question of Professor Chinmay, you know, if Chinmay, he'll actually give a very informed answer. He's your next speaker. Do ask him this question. My own understanding is that we have to first fix the notion of a living and fair wage. Okay, let's get that and not make that the subject of kind of compromise. We say that this is what it takes for a household to survive, for a worker's household to survive, and then build the business and the economic model around that, rather than flip it the other way to say this is what is now available for the worker. Okay, in many corporates, there is an interesting kind of, you know, analysis that I was recently reading, that the payouts to senior management, okay, are so large that they can actually account for social security kind of bills for the bottom 20% of the entire workforce of the company per year. Just the top 10% of the management will be paid so much money, which can actually cover the social security bill for the top bottom 20% of the workforce, right? Now, you know, those kinds of wage disparities have to be questioned. You know, we can't take that for granted, that we will live with the idea that our CEOs and CFOs and CTOs can be paid, you know, some unthinkable amount of money, while the worker in the supply chain will live at 250 rupees a day. Okay, it's a So there is need for rationalizing this wage disparity, okay, which sensible economies do that. Okay, they reduce the wage disparity within their, they will not make it 500x or 600x. They try to bring that gap narrow. Of course, people should not be paid equally. You know, the supply chain worker and the CEO cannot be paid equally, but you reduce that gap and therefore make more free up resources to be distributed more evenly in that system across, right? The other thing is that there is a role for public provisioning in these scenarios. What does China do? China picks up the bill on housing, nutrition, food, healthcare, almost entirely. The state picks it up, okay? Which is why once that has been sorted out, once that has been kind of dealt with, those are seen as investments in workers' productivity, okay? That being done, then the overall kind of system moves up, okay? There's more productive workforce because housing, food, healthcare has been taken care of, education has been taken care of. And so the whole system moves up. Right now, we are a very extractive kind of system in which we are not providing this, wages are low, okay? And we are saying that there is not enough margin play to do more for the workers. I think public provisioning has a role to help move up the economy, and especially through the worker route, through the workforce route, not just through fiscal policy for incentivizing industry and corporate, that needs to be done, but also ensuring that there is enough being invested in the productivity and the health of the workforce. But you know, these are of course fiscal policy issues, that where will money be freed up. Mostly when we visit supply chains and vendors, smaller players, they have exactly what you're saying. Paisa nahi hai, we don't get so much, our margins are too small to be doing more for the workers. They will not be able to do more for the workers. I think the responsibility will have to come to larger corporates to share more downwards, and for public provisioning to kind of kick in more easily. But we should, as I said earlier, that we should also agree to something, a wage platform as a decent one, and not make that negotiable. Not say that it is okay to pay a woman 80 rupees a day for sewing buttons on a collar. Okay, that should not be the case. We should accept that this is the least amount of money that is needed for all workers in this country, and build our economic model around that.
Rajiv, I'm Mansoor from UNICEF Bihar field office. Thank you so much for sharing your perspectives on the issues of migrant workers, and also the global solutions that you have mentioned in this conference presentation. My question is, as you know, like every fifth migrant worker is a child. Unfortunately, the current legislative framework doesn't really recognize a person below the age of 18 as a worker. In that case, and if you look at the kind of migration, of unsafe migration of young people going from the source to destination states, what are the protection mechanisms would be established to ensure that they are engaged at the same time, their interests are protected?
You're talking about a migration among the younger workforce?
Yes, young people is below the age of 18, especially between 14 and 70 years.
You know, that kind of migration has to be discouraged. You know, it has to be discouraged by making solid investments in our schooling and educational infrastructure. It is the breakdown of schooling and the breakdown of schools. By in Rajasthan, where I am from, the average age of first entry is 14 years. Okay, in the labor market, that should just not be acceptable. You know, we need. Children have to go through school, and I think before we think of safer migration for younger people, which is a reality, we have to make strong, solid arguments for strengthening schooling system in high out migration regions. Everywhere else, schooling system is needed, but especially in regions that are so prone to high out migration, we need the education infrastructure has to become stronger, including the whole conceptualization of seasonal hostels, which can prevent migration of young children who are accompanying their parents as they go out for work, right? That's one thing. Secondly, especially for younger, you know, for adolescent migration, we need a stronger vigilance system. You know, the terms at which they are being trafficked or being taken away, those can be very, very exploitative. And we need systems to both monitor and enforce kind of, you know, laws around that. My general feeling is that we should not sanitize this form of work. It should not be sanitized. It should be discouraged and prevented. And however more difficult it can be, because that is the starting point of a whole generation of vulnerability, and we should definitely come in the way of that. I mean, that's my view. Of course, there are guidelines around child labor, but wherever younger people are migrating is a sign of deep distress. It's like where women are migrating. For us, when women start to migrate, it means there's complete breakdown of all economic kind of, you know, resources, you know, in the villages, and it's a sign that we need to do something urgently before women start to migrate. Yeah. So I'm sorry, I don't have a, I just feel that we must come in the way of young people's migration.
Hello, sir.
That's the last question.
Yes, please.
The last question was adding into the same question. Like, I have been to my development mission to Rajasthan. So I have interacted with few of the children over there. So they are in the between age of 15 to 18. And they have a whole family to take care of their mother and their smaller children, like brother and sisters in their houses. So how can their livelihood be taken care of? Because they're sending them to the school is not compulsion. At the end of the day, they need something to eat and they have to earn something for their family. So what can you do in such
aspects? See, this is why I call for greater social protection. You know, that when there are these families that are unable to make ends meet, that have to send children out to make their own, you know, for their own survival, it is completely possible to ensure that these families have upgraded food allocations, they have guaranteed NREGA access, they have assured healthcare, so that the basics are being taken care of and where children are not being forced into these kinds of situations, right? The fact is that we don't provide the basics, and then we look for ways to legitimize kind of younger people's migration or make it more lucrative, which I don't think we should. I mean, it's a position, and I'm saying that 20% of our households here in our geography in South Rajasthan are of that kind. They're ultra poor, right? They need a safety net of greater number of NREGA days, of insured healthcare, and of nutrition and employment. You know, that's absolutely needed. Otherwise, there are people who will argue for skilling and training, providing vocational training to young people so that they have a better chance. Anyway, they have no hope for doing, you know, much more in schools and so on. But as a position, I don't support that. I would say we have to do better than this. I know we are out of time. It's past 10:45, but yeah.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your deep understanding of the subject of livelihood in terms of pandemic based on your vast research and experience. I'm sure we all have benefited from your talk. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. And good wishes for your foundation day. And I will tune into the next session as well.